Let me cover one more thing. Like when I was saying, like it will further increase the rift. For example, I can talk about as a Bhakt actually or Hindu. Okay, so for example, when you guys are attacking the world view, I'm saying the world view of the Hindu. For example, you guys are Hindu Bhakt. Okay. Yeah, for the Hindu Bhakt, like you guys are casteist, you follow caste system, you follow sati, you follow some monkey gods, you follow some and blah, 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 right? I mean, see, I'm an open-minded, right? I do, okay, these are like sacred to me, but I'm open-minded.
Monkey god sacred to you?
Yes, I can, it is sacred, okay. No, it's no issues, it is private to me, okay. But okay, I will tell you one thing, just one liner I will tell you. You can call it as a monkey god. It is objective realization for you, objective realization. But for me, as a subjective realization, you can read about objective and subjective, the Kant philosophy, right? Objective and subjective realization, it is divine for me. I don't look at it as the monkey which you are looking. When it collapses in my mind, it becomes a divinity. And same thing goes for Muslims also. I mean, I give respect to them. I don't talk about, you know, because they look things in a subjective way. The way I look at it, if you hate upon them, they're going to become more, you know, arrogant. Actually, they're not.
Yeah, but this is an objective claim, though. It might be a subjective realization, however you want to put it. But I'm sure Immanuel Kant wasn't talk about it on those terms. But if you want to have this is an objective claim that a monkey god did exist, or how universe came into existence, and all of that. And this is because the claim is objective. That's why we can look into it objectively as well. Sure, you can look into anything
objectively. Fair enough. See, if you keep on talking,
and we can talk about it.
Yeah. Okay. I don't think the Bhakts or the Hindus are really offended when you talk like he's a monkey or anything. Actually, they just ignore it. I know the psychology of Hindu.
But he does look like a monkey. But he does look like a monkey.
Okay, fair enough. Okay, maybe to you, but not to me, right? Okay.
So Hanuman is not supposed to be a monkey god.
I don't say. For me, I'm looking at the subjective realization, which is divinity part. I'm not looking whether he was a monkey, whether he's a rat. For me, what I'm looking at, he's a bhakt of Lord Ram. Okay, yeah, maybe.
That's a cop out. I would even say, go as far as saying that shows the lack of depth of these ancient people, that they could not even be innovative when they were making up their mythological stories. I'll explain what I mean by that. Muhammad, when he thought about I'm gonna invent a space vehicle, he didn't imagine a long tube like a rocket or a flying saucer disc or something. He couldn't say just a flying donkey, because that would be too obvious. That is zero innovation. So he goes, smaller than a mule, but bigger than a donkey, had a huge wingspan. So he's putting some innovation in that, some intuition in that, or creativity in that, but not enough. But it's still kind of like a donkey and a mule.
So same way
with your ancients as well. They want to come up with some divine creature. They go, monkey. What does face look like? A monkey, but he had hands like a human. And same thing we look at in Greek mythology as well, like a half lion, half human, you know, a two-headed snake. That's why I say, I mean, you know, these are objective claims, unfortunately.
Let me try, even though I'm not an expert in this, let me try to give some explanation. Yeah, I mean, I'm telling my weakness also. I'm not expert in everything, okay? So do you agree? But you're defending this worldview. Let me give it a try. You know that in human evolution, the way we are seeing, like we had Neanderthals before us, right? We had Neanderthals just 2,500 years, right? And their features were not human-like. We know that, right? And if you go before that, human habilis, I think actually, right? Human habilis. And there were a lot of species which were monkey-likes. Actually, they were like monkey-likes. And there has been archaeological proofs in the Indian subcontinent that human beings were actually interacting with other species, similar human species, which were not human beings.
Hominids. And yeah, they were hominids.
Yes. So we don't know. I'm just keeping it open. Actually. Yeah. We don't know.
No. Okay, all right. I got to stop you there. Because again, see, this is the problem with religious people. that their worldviews are so ridiculous within themselves that they have to rely on anything they can get a hold of. And this is what Muslims say as well. You know what Muslims say about Waqia Miraj, about the Muhammad's night journey? They relate it with time dilation. They say, well, you know, like when you're traveling at the speed of light, the world, their time slows down. So, you know, and that's exactly what Muhammad would have done, because, you know, when Muhammad came back, the bed was still warm. And in Shia version, the door ring was still going back and forth, and Muhammad was already back and he had done all the. So they rely on, and this is what you just did. You use the hominid species. And you say, well, it could, but we know the hominid species could not speak. They could not perform miracles. They could not fly. They couldn't do any of those things. But because you found a little correlation somewhere that, oh, we did evolve from apes who had faces like more, they look more monkey than humans. So you go, okay, maybe I see an opening there. Let me try to insert that. But how do you defend that? That, okay, if these ancients are talking about those hominid species, by the way, those hominids were actually really short. The Lucy and all of these guys were only 3 feet tall. Neanderthals, yes, they were about 5'6", 5'7", sure. But the earlier we go, these hominids were actually shorter and shorter. So now you're saying, okay, well, maybe the ancients were talking about those hominids. But we know that hominids could not speak.
Okay,
they were very primitive.
I think you're doing a little bit straw man on my weak point. I didn't say about
habilis.
I did. Okay. I heard
you. You threw in hominids there. Of course, okay, I had to use that.
Okay. I didn't say. I said like we had like habilis. Similarly, there may be other species which were like this. I'm not saying that this is the species whom habilis. I said similar to.
So Hanuman had a special species. So
I don't know actually.
No, but it could be. You're saying could be.
Yeah, I could be. Yes, could be.
Yeah, so Hanuman could be. It could be. Or it could be a figment of someone's imagination. Is that possible? It could be a lie as well. It could have been made up as well. I'm being generous with you. You said you're open-minded. So, you know, you guys are not actually open-minded. You guys are only open-minded when it suits you. So it could be false as well. Someone could have just made it up. Let's just say it could exist. Hanuman could be there. There could be a whole species of Hanumans running around there. And it could also be made up, right? Do you agree on that?
Yeah, it may be, because I don't have evidence to prove that. So as a scientific approach of discussing, I can say I'm open-minded, like 50%, 50%, because if you see, they were not talking about one Hanuman. They were talking about thousands of his Sena, Banar Sena. And you remember, they were never, they said it like Banar Sena, right? I think there is a word actually, which, so similarly, Jambudip, like he was like this bear like Jambo. Like he was like a bear like person. So it's not one actually, like they were talking and
let's just stick this. So again, you threw in subjective realization, objective realization, but then you try to use objective facts to somehow defend, because unfortunately it's a human desire to seek evidence and to seek answers. And this is why when we push these people, and it's reminding me of this. See, have a look at this. Somebody asked this question to Neeraj Atri. He said, yes, also listen to Ghalib and Haris criticizing you. How to counter and give logic of Lord Ganesha with the elephant head, etc. And I think he probably meant to ask about Hanuman, the flying monkey as well. Because these people want to find objective reason, not subjective realization. They want objective answers to defend their beliefs. And the only reason you're defending it, because you have the social affinity to it. As Shuprita said, no hominids who were contemporary to humans have the archaeological remnants in India. Oh, okay. I didn't know that, Shuprita. But even if they were, let's just say even if they were, I think it would be far outrageous to assume that those hominids were so advanced, they had a whole Sena, they had a whole army. We haven't found one single one of them who were that big and all that. The Muslims, you know how Muslims counter that? Let me give you some pointers from them. What, you know what they say? Lack of evidence is no evidence. So you could say that as well. You know, look, just because they haven't found them doesn't mean they didn't exist. So you can use that. You know, you can use that. But we have a principle, we have a worldview here that we're dealing with. We're dealing with that if it doesn't have any evidence, we're not going to believe in it. We can. Now, we are the true open-minded people, not you. Because you believe in it, But then you say we're open to discussion. But your first position is believing in Hanuman existing. Our position is, okay, maybe he existed, maybe he didn't. But you know why we think that he may not have existed? Because there is no evidence of that. So we're saying we think that it probably didn't. And you know why other things, amongst so many other things as well, like pink elephant, Muhammad's flying donkey and all of that, we have the same, and demons and jinns and paris and fairies and all of that. We have the same approach towards them as well, because on the same principle, it's highly unlikely. And first of all, there's actually no evidence of that. So we're the open-minded ones, not you.
Lack of evidence. We are saying, like, we are again and again emphasizing lack of evidence, but that is no proof to saying that it doesn't exist. I mean, you know that one of these fallacies, right? Lack of evidence, definitely. Yes, we do accept that, yes, there is evidence to prove that, okay, this is this and we can prove that. But at the same time, I mean, tell me, Harris, how does it matter whether, I mean, if I believe in it, let's say I'm believing in it, am I harming to this planet? Am I becoming less rational?
Absolutely less rational.
How do you say that?
I'll tell you that.
How do you say that I'm less rational?
Because you have the whole of Indian civilization to look at. Because there are people, when you start believing in ancient text as sacred, when you start believing that things can be believed in without hard evidence. Now, we don't believe in jinns and fairies because there's no evidence. You know, pink elephants probably exist, maybe exist. They might exist, one could argue, because, you know, just because you haven't found pink elephant doesn't mean they don't exist. Or, you know, some dinosaurs might be existing in some Amazonian forest we haven't discovered yet. But we're not going to believe in that as fact because there's no evidence. So you, on the other hand, religious people... Sorry, I'm going to have to put you on mute because I can hear some noise. Religious people believe in things as sacred because some ancient people wrote it and then you believe in it without evidence. So that is the exact opposite of being rational, because rational is we're going to believe in something that is logically coherent or empirically coherent in either forms of evidences. So once you open yourself to that, then you can believe. If you can believe in flying Hanuman, flying monkey, then you can believe in Muhammad's flying donkey as well. And they both oppose each other doctrinally, scripturally. They both have different worldviews. But the point is, from that logical standpoint, you can believe in that as well. And I know you said that. You said that you don't make fun of people believing Muhammad's flying donkey. But we object, we rationalists, we people who try to find objective answers to everything, we have a certain methodology. You can disagree with that, but it makes more sense. That worldview has given rockets and airplanes and everything. Believing in fairies and jinns doesn't directly give you anything. So once you can believe in that, then you can believe in kundalis. You can believe in astrology. Because again, because we respect your worldview, is we respect what ancient said. So that spoke about astrology as well. There's a Mahurat Nikala Jala Jara. You have to find the best day. Astrology, magic. All of those things are ripe. Our region is plagued by those views. And it's in India, Pakistan as well. And Bangladesh, and in other parts of the world, parts of the world have different worlds of views of superstition, but they're all irrational. And flying monkey is smack bang in the middle. If you can believe in flying monkey, you can believe in Mahurat, you can believe in astrology, what is the best day to get married, you can believe in all of that. And that harms the world, because then when you get cancer, when you get some sort of a mental illness, people think, oh, there's a jinn in you. There is some sort of a, you know, you can argue, because why people say, well, that's not in Hinduism, because people take scriptures at their own comfort. Whatever suits them the most, they will take it. So you would believe in flying Hanuman, but you might not believe in, I don't know, I'm just assuming, but some other Hindu. For example, the last Hindu guy who came, he said, I believe in Atma Paramatma, but Atma, at the end, he just said, when he couldn't defend it, he said, Atma just means energy. And energy can be in that cup as well. So this is what irrationality, and by irrationality, I mean something that is not supported by either by logic or empirical evidence. And Hanuman is not supported by either. You are opening yourself to anything, and that is a harmful thing to society.
Fair enough. So I think one more thing I was saying is I think the word banner, it means monkey. I think it is not there in I may be wrong, but I have to check. It is not there in Ramayana. There is a so it always it never says like monkey. And the second point I wanted to give
what
you
is
one
it,
more.
What would it be? Though? What
I have
would
to refresh. I think it is not talking about Vanar in the sense of monkey. So it explicitly means that it is not a monkey. First of all, it is not a monkey. It is like a species. It is a species, but it is not monkey. It never addressed as monkey. What you are saying, like monkey. It is never addressed as monkey in actual Valmiki Ramayana. So it says like Hanuman. Hanuman is never addressed as monkey. That's like the English, the Westerners' view. Okay, and I mean for you folks. Okay, the second thing, was it
like Muhammad, like small, larger than a monkey but smaller than Homo sapiens?
To help me produce more videos like these, support me on Patreon or PayPal.